from Brother Cleghorn here in just a minute. It's great to have the Cleghorns, Tim and Kara, and I really enjoy every time they're able to come through. It's just kind of like you got friends, some friends you just kind of pick up right where they left off, you know, and I would count the Cleghorns as some of those, and I know they're great friends with the Morelands and Yoders as well, but we'll look forward to hearing from them in a moment. I'm going to ask Mrs. Taylor to come and sing a special, and then as soon as she's finished, Brother, you come right on ahead, all right?
My soul, my Savior God, to heart has already been blessed through the songs and everything. How great thou art. My heart wants to sing to the Lord this morning. How great thou art. I hope yours does too. And they sang one of my favorites as a special this morning. Is that good? They sang, I Can Go In. And that's what it's all about. I can go in, for my heart is freed from sin. Jesus said, rejoice not that the devils are subject to you, but rather rejoice that your name is written in heaven. I hope your name is written in heaven this morning. We can rejoice in that together. And if it's not, I hope it will be by the end of today. Amen. Well, I'm Tim Cleghorn. This is my wife, Kara, right back here. And we have our son, Levi, terrorizing the nursery back there probably. And he's 2.5 years old. And he also speaks a little bit of Chinese, which is fun to hear him. He's hilarious. And then we have a second child on the way, due in September. And so I'm excited to be here with you as your missionary. The last time we were traveling around, we were traveling around to raise support, to present the ministry and be like, hey, you know, hey everybody, we're going to go do this. Would you like to support us? But, I mean, all the pressure is gone because we're here. We're part of your family. You guys have been supporting us. You guys have been there with us. You guys have been reading our letters. You guys know what things that have gone on for us as we've been overseas and as we've been back in the States for a few months now. And so I'm just rejoicing to be here as part of you, as an extension of your ministry, and to see what the Lord is doing here. So I'm praising the Lord for that. And I want to give you a little bit of an update about our family and about how things are going in the ministry. But I'm just going to do a little bit of that this morning, and I'm going to give you some more of that in the evening service tonight. So I hope that you'll be here tonight. I want to have a lot of fun. I hope that you guys have a lot of fun in both services today. I want us to pray that the Lord will just be here, that he will meet with us and bless us all day long. So I'm also totally tickled that your pastor is in India. I know this is not the first time that he's been, but you guys can feel proud of him. You guys can feel absolutely proud that you have a pastor that does this. Most people don't. And a lot of pastors, you know, they're like, well, you know, for different reasons, either they can't or they're not real interested to, you know, go and travel to places like this. And would Pastor Slabaugh have to go over there? No, it's something that he's volunteering to do. I'll bet you he's spending a lot of his own personal money to do it. And he wouldn't have to. So you guys can be real thankful that he does that. I do want to say, though, that when he gets back, you'll have to ask him about a few things because he may not tell you the whole story. And I can tell you this as an insider because I've been to the place that where he's preaching at in India a few times before with Brother Fielder, and some of the things you can't really discuss when you come back to the States. And so I'm going to give you a little bit of insider scoop, and then you can probably shouldn't ask him if this has happened or whatever. But there at the college there, I have a really good friend. His name is Achung. His whole name is Achung Pao, which is to me just the coolest name ever. Right, and so he's just a great guy. And there, in their culture, I wasn't really aware of it the first time I went of how things work. And you know, when you get to be close friends with a guy, you know, we're there in chapel one time, and we're sitting beside each other, and we hear this preaching, and it was really good. And we had been fellowshipping, we had compared some stories, we had talked about how we both really liked to hunt. He was from the jungle; he had hunted cool things like tigers and wild boar. I hunt deer and stuff like that. So we had this automatic connection. And so we walk out from the service, and we're coming down the steps, and I feel this hand grab mine. And I reach over, and he's holding my hand. So we're just walking down the steps together, and then we walk down the street, and I'm just like, if any of my friends in the States could see me now, they would have serious questions. So if that happens to Pastor while he's over there, just pretend like it didn't, okay? Just pretend like you don't know anything about it. Don't bring it up. I wouldn't. Other cool things happen there on campus. Just funny things, you know, things that people do and say. But the last time I was there, which would have been November, the students found a big old cobra. And a student came running to the classroom, and he says, Tim, sir, they found a big cobra. They killed a cobra. And I'm like, wait, I'm coming. I want to see it. And so I want to eat it with them, you know, because when the students find a cobra, in minutes, it's gone. Yeah. Well, I didn't get to because they ate it too fast. Just boom, you know. So anyways, just I'm glad your pastor's there, and I'm so tickled about that. And I'm glad that I can be here with you guys. I know that we're missing another important face this morning, Brother Ron Moreland, not being here. I really miss him. I've been talking with him on and off the past couple weeks about the meeting today. And he also has a good reason for not being able to be here this morning. He had he had some plastic surgery done. I mean, he's got bandages all over his face. You know, I guess he finally started to feel really embarrassed about showing this, you know, in public setting. So, I mean, don't ask me how I know, but he did get me to send some photos to the plastic surgeon so that he could look more like. Okay. I heard that. Where's the camera? I want to be able to address him directly. Is that? Hey, Brother Ron. No, actually, I want to talk to you about Brother Ron a little bit. The Lord has really done some great things in Brother Ron's life, and I got to confess, you know, because we're in church, I've got to be strictly honest. The reason he wanted me to come here today is kind of like as a secret agent type thing to tell you about how, you know, how wonderful, you know, him and his family is and all these kind of things. So that's the purpose for me being here today. So now I'm back on track with him there. He's not going to kill me when I see him on Monday morning. Okay, all right, let's rein it in. I'll try to bring it into a more serious note here. The Lord has been really good to our family over the past couple of years. And we arrived in China not that long after we were here with you guys in the missions conference. And so, let's see, it would have been July, first part of July in 2015, we arrived in China. And our first year in China, my wife and I have both talked about it a lot. We have had, you know, kind of a tough year in a lot of ways. There have been some challenges, but we both agree that it's been the best year of our lives. Why? That's what we're here to talk about today. I mean, I love the theme that you guys have. I love my church, and we have so many reasons to love our church. I like what this brother back here says. He's like, he stood up here and he's like, I don't know what to do with hammer and nails, but I'm not sure about this stuff and addressing. And it's like, that's kind of what I feel like after not having been in the pulpit much for a long time, because in China, you know, that's not what we've been doing. And so this is, we have so many reasons to love our church. We have so many reasons to love missions. And when Brother Ron actually approached me first and said, I want you to preach something about I love missions, I've been thinking about it really hard since then. Like, what am I going to talk about that will do justice to that topic, that will help each of us to worship the Lord together along the lines of loving missions and rejoicing in that? And so I've been thinking about our first year on the mission field being the best year of our lives. And I thought, that's exactly what I'm going to talk about this morning. You know, because I know that you guys have many different missionaries, so I don't want to talk much about us this morning. It's not about us, it's not about our family, it's not about our particular mission field. It's about the general topic of missions and why we take part in it and why we love it with all of our hearts. And so I think the best thing I can do this morning is talk to you about why I love missions. And I hope that this will be some stuff that will also be relatable to your life and inspire you and encourage you. And tonight we're going to talk about how you guys love missions, because it's obvious that you do. The number of missionaries that you guys have represented here, the number of missions efforts based from here that you guys have speaks for itself. And so this morning I want to talk about why I love missions. And I hope that this will really encourage you. So to begin with, let's just lift up this morning's service to the Lord in a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you so much for this day. I just praise you for the opportunity to be here and worship together in your house with these folks, Lord. Thank you so much for their faithful support for us over the past couple of years. And just please bless them for that, Lord, and help us to be able to give them some blessing in return this morning. Just use the message, Lord, speak through me. In your name we pray. Amen. All right, missions, and why I love missions. I think first, I want to discuss the topic a little bit about what missions is. All right, now, I don't want to think about it strictly from a theological standpoint with this question, but let's think more practically about what it means to us. Because a lot of times, I remember being a young man and coming into the call to the mission field, and right away starting to feel, you know, this thing about missions being, you know, like saving the world. Right? So that's what it's about, right? And it kind of ties in with all the, you know, everything we see in media these days with mainstream movies and all this kind of stuff. It's not a legitimate story unless there's a plot where the world is going to be destroyed and then someone comes in and saves the world, right? And, you know, and I've learned that that's not what missions is. But, you know, sometimes we can think that, you know, okay, so It's about saving the world, you know? It's about, you know, being some, you know, Superman or superhero and doing this. You know, we all want to stand up and we want to say, and I can tell you this as a missionary. And, you know, one thing I'm thankful for is that already being with family, with supporters, I feel really free this morning to preach. There's nothing that we can gain. You guys already support us. And so I just want to say, put out there what the Lord's laid on our hearts. And I can say some things to you guys that maybe missionaries from here, like the Morelands or others, can't say because, you know, this is their home. They're from here. So, you know, I think in the missionary's mind, all right, let's go there for a minute. You know, we all think that we all want to stand up and be able to say, you know, I liberated a country, right? I liberated Lithuania or somewhere, you know. We might think of missions as the terms of, like, the military with a mission, you know, and we can think of ourselves as, you know, like being on the spear point of something and then having these, you know, secret operators in the background on the aircraft carrier or whatever. Okay, Operation Baptist Blackout is a go, I repeat, you know, and then we launch into this hostile environment and we do all this stuff. But, you know, all those ideas, there's a problem. There's one problem with all of that. I don't know any Superman. Oh, I forgot. Ron, you're listening. no, seriously. I know some people who are close, but I don't know any Superman. I don't know any superheroes. I don't know any big, glamorous thing. Woo, you know, we did liberate a country. We this and that and the other. I don't know any of those things that have to do with missions. It doesn't fit. You know, we sang a song this morning called On a Hill Far Away, and it says, in the old rugged cross, a wondrous attraction I see. And that's more what it's about right there, is, you know, that rugged cross was not super glamorous, and there was not, and nowadays, knowing what Jesus did there for us, we can look back at the cross and see where Jesus bought the freedom for the whole entire world. But when you just think about the cross in particular, there's not a lot of glamour wrapped up in it, just pain. There's not a lot of heroism, you know, in the suffering of being nailed to a cross, except now that when we look back at the suffering Jesus did that bought our freedom, we can see it from in the beginning. So we have to think about missions. We kind of have to take away the glamour from it a little bit because it really doesn't fit, you know? We are not anything special. We're not anybody, you know, we're not Superman. We don't liberate countries. We don't come in and save the world. We don't do any of that stuff. So what do we do, and what is it about? To understand really why I love missions, I want to begin to talk about something far more humble. We have to scale it way back. I want to bring it back and start to talk about the smallest thing that I know of, the smallest thing that you can see. I want to talk about dust, all right? That's my topic this morning. This is a whole message about dust. Now, you might imagine where I'm going with this, but try not to. Just think about dust. I'm talking about real dust. What is it? Dust, if I have to explain it for kindergarten kids, it's that small particles that floats everywhere. It stuffs up your nose. It clogs up your throat. It gets in your eyes. It irritates your eyes. It's on everything. It's in your house. It's on your car, it's on our clothes, it's all throughout our life, it's everywhere, it's on our shoes, it's the crust on everyone's shoes. I can't think of anything lower, smaller, or more humble, or base than dust. I've been around dust all my life in one form or another. When I was a kid, my dad had a sawmill, and we would run the sawmill day in and day out. And it was a band sawmill, and if anybody knows what a band sawmill is, it makes really fine dust. So you're up there just pulling lumber and rolling logs and stuff, and just dust, you know, and just it's just all packed through your nose and your eyes, and then you can just, you know, knock piles of it off of your hair after you're working for a few hours in the dust. It'll kill you, you know, and you just hate the dust. And then I went to college in Texas, and that speaks for itself. It's like flour in all the roads, you know, on all the cars. Nathan, isn't it? Everywhere down there, I mean, just it's dust. And I thought it was bad. And then our family moved to the real desert. If I could show you some pictures of the area that we live in Western China, you would think, is that Arabia or somewhere? Because seriously, it's just desert. There's areas where I've, you know, whole towns where you can look all around the town. You can drive for miles and miles and miles and not find a blade of grass. And when the wind kicks up there, you really hate the dust. Now, dust, it's not only irritating to us. It's not only, invasive. It invades every part of our life. It makes us look bad. Don't look at my shoes right now. Don't look at my car. But it's the foundation that everything is built on. This church, beneath this church, is dust, right? Beneath the streets are dust. Beneath all this grass and all this lawn out here, beneath it all is dust. So I just want us to think about dust for a bit, and I want us to think about how humble dust is. In Matthew chapter 10, when Jesus told the disciples to go two by two into all these cities and preach about him, he says, now, if they won't receive you, what do? He's like, you shake off the dust of your feet as a testimony against them. Now, that's dust. Dust comes in many different forms. You have sawdust. You have drywall dust. You have construction dust. You have regular dirt dust. You have dust, the dust that gets in your house, like house dust, which is somewhat different. But in Deuteronomy chapter 28 and verse 24, Jesus talks about dust, this is Moses writing here, jumping ahead of myself. Deuteronomy 28 and verse 24, he talks about dust as a curse. It says, and the Lord, and this, he's talking to Israel and says, if you reject God, this is what's going to happen. It says, and the Lord shall make the rain of thy land powder and dust. From heaven shall it come down upon thee until thou be destroyed. This is the way I felt in China sometimes. There was most of the time in our apartment, if you open the windows, if the wind is really not doing much, you can open the windows and enjoy just a little bit of fresh breeze. But if the wind kicks up at all, you open the windows, and we were up on the sixth floor. So if you open the windows for about an hour, you'd come in just thick dust on everything. Every day you sweep a pile of dust off the floor. A pile of dust. And then we go out to some different villages in the desert here and there and just sand and dust and just get in there. And it's a curse. And Jesus, God said, I'll make dust rain upon you until I've consumed you if you forget God. Well, this is dust. This is the dust we're talking about. Dust being a curse. Dust, think about dust being the dirt on every battlefield that soaks up the blood of martyrs and heroes. Think about dust being beneath even the trash on the street. That's dust. There's one more thing about dust. The most important thing about dust, it's us. Genesis chapter 2. Genesis chapter 2 and verse 7. Genesis chapter 2 and verse 7. Now be patient with me while I go through a little bit of dust discussion here, and we're going to bring this to why I love missions. You might say, well, that's a jump right there. Yes, it is. That's why I love missions. Dust. Genesis chapter 2 and verse 7. It says, and the Lord God formed man of the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living soul. Think about that. So of all the things that God made in this world, of all the wonderful things that there are, he reached down and he's like, I'm going to make man. I'm going to make something in my image. And what am I going to use? And he picked up dust. I don't like dust. But God reached down and touched some dust, and he picked it up, and he formed it into a man, and he breathed into his nostrils the breath of life. And man became a living soul. In the next chapter, Genesis chapter 3 and verse 19, if you'll read one verse over there for me real quick, Genesis chapter 3 and verse 19, the Bible says, in the sweat of thy face shalt thou eat bread till thou return unto the ground. For out of it wast thou taken. Dust thou art, and unto dust shalt thou return. This is what we are, guys. Now, I'm sorry for all of us who, like myself, sometimes get to thinking that we're something, all right? look what I did, or look who I am. This is really what we are. This is our ingredients right here. What's our ingredients? Dust. All right, so let's think about it. Dust being the most humble and the most base thing. And God took that and made us, and he's like, okay, you are dust. And there's several times throughout the scriptures when Ahab, the king of Israel, thought he was all cocky and he went out. The prophet came to Ahab and he says, now look, I raised you up out of the dust. And there's many times throughout the scriptures that some man begins to think that he's something, and God comes and reminds him and says, hey, you're dust. I made you out of dust. You're going to go back to dust. So just take it into a little bit of perspective here. I'm God, you're dust. God, dust. Now when we think about dust, there's not much difference in comparing the goodness of one dust and another dust. Which dust is the best? Which dust is the worst or a little bit better than this dust? Okay? Now, you know exactly where I'm going with this. There's differences between some different dusts. There's dusts that are more annoying on a construction site. Amen, brother? I mean, drywall dust, you know, I mean, it's pretty bad because it's small and stuff like this. But when you compare dust to a person, the differences between the sizes of the dust is so insignificant that it's not worth mentioning. Is that true? Now, let's think about us. In Romans chapter 9, I'm sorry, that's not the verse that I'm looking for here. Let's see. Ecclesiastes, I jumped ahead again. Ecclesiastes chapter 3 and verse 20. Ecclesiastes chapter 3 and verse 20. In Ecclesiastes 3:20, we see something about this topic of dust. One dust isn't better than another one. Ecclesiastes chapter 3 and verse 20, it says, all go unto one place. All are of the dust, and all turn to dust again. Okay, so let's think of the world leaders right now. The most common question I get from different people in China is about Obama. They love Obama. And I'm a little bit afraid about when I go back about what they're going to be asking me now. Because I don't think they're going to love Trump. I like a lot of things that Trump is doing, but when I go back to China, I'm going to have to just be like, all right, let's not discuss politics. All right, I'm living in your country. You're going to stone me to death if I talk about Trump, you know. All right, let's skip it. If Trump is going to turn into dust, so is Obama. So am I. So is Putin. So is the Chinese president, Xi Jinping. That's his name, kind of weird name. All of us, you and I, we're all dust. And so when we think about the greatness of God and then our stature as what? As what again? As dust. Then the differences between you and I and the differences between our awesomeness or capabilities or all this kind of stuff that we like to compare, the differences between our efforts, the differences between our skills, all of those differences seem to do what? Go away. They seem to become pretty irrelevant when we look at ourselves as what we are in comparison with God, because we're dust. But where something special has happened to this dust. In Genesis chapter 2, if you'll think back to the verse we just read, God did something that it doesn't say he did for anything else. He took that humble dust, he took that lowly substance, he took that base, that disgusting stuff, and he took it and he did what? He breathed into it the breath of life. He made it in his image. There's nothing else that's made in God's image. He made it all to be just what he wanted it to be. He made the mountains, and he made all the animals, he made the natural world, and he made all this kind of stuff to be what it is, but he made us, he made this dust in his image. I love that. I call this meet the maker. When dust meets the maker, dust becomes something. So in case you get the idea that I'm here to tell everybody that you are nothing, well, that's true, but let's take it into perspective. With God, with the breath of life, with his image that he's made us in, we're a little more than just dust, all right? The Lord has done something special. Now, as I think about this, and as I think about God forming us and turning us in to exactly what he wants us to be, it's exactly that. He has made us exactly what he wants us to be. Now, I can think of us being made and formed of the dust and made from the clay, and I can think about how some of us aren't happy with what God made us and with who God made us sometimes. We really do like to compare ourselves with other people, whether it be looks or skills or capabilities or smartness or anything like that. I never stack up favorably if I start doing that, and so I can't go down that road. But many of us, and you know, it's a big thing in the news today, you know, with, it seems like the biggest thing in the news is people with that were, you know, body image issues and, people that were bullied or shamed in some way. You know what would solve that? People understanding that God made us into just what he wants us to be. Romans chapter 9, verse 21, if we could turn over there real quickly. Romans chapter 9, verse 21. And I'm going to turn to these passages pretty fast. And I want to get through this and before it gets too late for lunch. I know that's really important. So if I turn too quickly for some of you, I apologize in advance. But Romans chapter 9, verse 21 says, "Hath not the potter power over the clay of the same lump to make one vessel unto honor and another one unto dishonor?" This is like the potter is there and he's like, "All right, I'm going to make something special out of this clay and I'm going to make it this way." And then the vessel says, I don't like being this. And the potter says, "Well, I'm the one that has power to make you this, and I know what I need you for, and so this is what I've made you." And that's what God has done for each of us. God has made us exactly what he wants us to be. But we're still dust. Now, this is the part that I really want us to focus on, because this is where it gets good. The next point is what God can do with dust. What God can do with dust. Psalm chapter 40. Psalm chapter 40. I want you to turn to two passages, Psalm chapter 40 and Psalm 113. Psalm 40 and Psalm 113, as we talk about what God can do with dust. Because now that we've looked inwardly a little bit and we've talked about what we are, I want to talk about what God can do with us. What can God do with dust? Psalm chapter 40 and verse 2. Psalm 40 and verse 2. We'll start in verse 1, actually. It says, "I waited patiently for the Lord, and he inclined unto me and heard my cry. He brought me up also out of an horrible pit, out of the miry clay, and set my feet upon a rock and established my goings." It says, this talks about when God reached down and took that dust. It says he reached down and brought me out of a horrible pit. Think in your minds a little bit about where God brought you up from, okay? All right? Did God bring you up from somewhere? You're here this morning. It gets lower than this, guys. Church is a good place. God has brought us up from something. God has brought us up from who we are. In Psalm 113 and verse 7, go there with me really quickly, 113:7, it says, "He raiseth up the poor out of the dust and lifteth the needy out of the dunghill." Jesus is the only one. God is the only one who can reach down and take dust and lift it up. He can take the poor and lift him up out of the dust. He can reach down and get clay and lift it up out of a miry pit and turn it into something. Now, John chapter 9, this is the heart of the message right here. John chapter 9. When we go to John chapter 9, we see Jesus doing something with dust. And I love this picture. In John chapter 9, we see the story of a blind man. Now, the streets of Jerusalem, I like to think about the streets of Jerusalem being just like the streets of a lot of villages that we see in China. Because a lot of the villages they have houses made out of mud and stones with some straw and kind of on the roof. And the streets are just dirt and dust, and you walk along those streets and dust just kicks up. It gets all over your shoes. And I think that's the way that the streets of Jerusalem were. All right? Dust. Dust everywhere. And that's where Jesus meets us, right? Jesus doesn't say you have to, you know, get your act together, become perfect, become like my image, and then I'll touch you. Jesus meets us in the dust. And Jesus was walking through this dusty street in Jerusalem, and he met a blind man. Dust all over the ground. Think about this picture. Now, John chapter 9, verses 1 through 7, let's read it. "And as Jesus passed by, he saw a man which was blind from his birth. And his disciples asked him, saying, Master, who did sin, this man or his parents, that he was born blind? And Jesus answered, Neither hath this man sinned, nor his parents, but that the works of God should be made manifest in him. I must work the works of him that sent me while it is day. The night cometh when no man can work. As long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world. And when he had thus spoken, he spat on the ground and made clay of the spittle and anointed the eyes of the blind man with the clay and said unto him, go wash in the pool of Siloam, which is by interpretation sent. He went his way, therefore, and washed and came seeing. Wow. Now you're thinking, that's weird. I agree. Why did Jesus do that? So think about, envision this. Because this is really the heart of the message this morning. Envision this happening. Jesus is going along, and he sees a blind man there who had been blind from his birth. And he stops, and he looks at him. And his disciples ask him, Lord, you know, it's obvious that somebody sinned here because nothing bad happens except from sin. So who sinned, this man or his parents? And Jesus says, let me tell you something. It's not about this man's sin or his parents, but that you can see something amazing that I'm going to do. Amen. And at that point, he just spit on the ground. And you're like, gross. Well, it gets better. He knelt down, and he took that dust that he had spit in, and he mixed it around. It says he made clay of the spittle. He mixed it around, took his fingers, got them dirty, squashed it around a bit, and he picked it up, and he came over to the blind man, and he put it in his eyes. And he said, go wash in the pool of Siloam. Let's think about that for a minute, because that is just highly irregular. Jesus didn't heal any other blind men that way. When Jesus healed a lame person, he didn't make mud and stick it on his knee. But Jesus wants us to see something special from this verse. Now here's what it is. Did Jesus have to use that clay to heal his eyes? No, he didn't. Couldn't if he had just said, boom, heal your eyes, and they'd have been healed? Sure. Then why did he? I don't know. But he did. Jesus said, I'm going to do an amazing work. And he's like, I'm not going to do it alone. I'm going to use something. And he reached down into the dust and he wet it. The word, the water of the word of God comes from Jesus' mouth. He wet the dust and he made clay and he took that and he used that. He didn't have to. He didn't need that dust. He didn't need that clay. He just decided to. And he picked it up and used it. And that's why I love missions. Because I'm dust. Because I'm nothing more than the dust on the street that Jesus was walking over. And there's a lost and dying world everywhere, all around us. There's blind men sitting on the wayside who need their eyes open to see the light of eternity. There's lame men who need to leap and praise God. There's dead who need raised. And Jesus says, I want to reach this world. That's his mission. That's his heart. And he's like, guess what? I'm going to use some dust to help me. That is me. And that is why I love missions. Let's look at the mission of God here. Isaiah chapter 42. Isaiah chapter 42. Isaiah 42 and verse 6 and 7. Now this is a prophetic passage talking about Jesus. Now think about him healing that blind man's eyes here as we read this passage. It says, I, the Lord, have called thee in righteousness, and I will hold thine hand, and will keep thee, and give thee for a covenant of the people, for a light of the Gentiles, to open the blind eyes, to bring out the prisoners from the prison, and them that sit in darkness from the prison house. I am the Lord, that is my name, and my glory will I not give to another, neither my praise to graven images. This is talking about who Jesus would be. And it says, I have sent him. God is talking. He says, I have sent him to open the eyes of the blind, to open the doors of the prison, to break down the walls, to make the lame leap. I've sent Jesus to do these things. And guess what? When I turn over to the New Testament and I see him healing that blind man's eyes and then reaching down and touching something as humble as the dust at his feet and using that to do it, I say, Lord, let me be that dust. Let me be that clay. Let me be that. Because the world that we look at, when we think about missions, and it's not just about missions in other countries, Missions is the same everywhere. In this town, in my town in China, in your town, everywhere, it's the same. There are people who need to see the truth. They need their eyes open. There are people who need to be set free from the prison. There are people who need to walk in the light. There are people who need to live and have the everlasting life that only God can give them. And He uses dust to do it. Now, let's think about God reaching the world today. Would God have to use us, or could He have chosen a different way? Well, He's God, and so He could have chosen something different. But He didn't. He chose us. He chose me and you. God has a mission for the world. And that mission is what we just read in Isaiah, to open the eyes of the blind. And go right on down the list. God has a mission. And how is He going to accomplish it? How is He going to do it? Is He going to reach out there in the sky? And this is a good illustration that preachers like to use. Is He going to ride it in the sky with clouds? He's not going to, because He didn't choose to do that. Is He going to do a number of other things that He could do? Why, no. He's going to reach down and take dust. Is that you? Are you the dust on the street? Is that us? That is us. He's going to reach down and take dust. And He's going to fill it with the water of His word. And He's going to make it who He wants it to be. And He's going to use us. He's going to use the most humble substance that we know of. He's going to use the most base substance. Dust. That's us. And that's why I love missions. Because I know who I am. A year in China has been really good at teaching me who I am. At teaching me the capabilities that I don't have. The patience that I don't have. The humility that I don't have. Teaching me that I'm dust, guys. I'm just dust. I'm clay. I'm formed from the ground. One day I'll go back to dust. But in between now and then, I want God to put His finger on me. I want Him to touch this dust and to take it and open somebody's eyes. That's what missions is. That's what missions is about. He's going to use us. He's going to pick me up. He's going to form me. He's going to breathe into me the breath of life. He's going to lift me out of a pit. He's going to use us to open the blind eyes. Ephesians chapter 3 and verse 8. Ephesians chapter 3 and verse 8. If I could just bring this home and make it and relate it to each one of us. Ephesians chapter 3 and verse 8. Ephesians 3, 8 says, now this is Paul talking. And Paul is writing to one of the churches of the Gentiles. Now just to tell you, the Gentiles, that's anybody except the Jews. Now, back in the day, the Jews thought they were the only ones that could be saved. Well, I'm glad that's not true, because I'm not a Jew. I'm a Gentile, okay? So the Gentiles were dirty, they were filthy, and they were looked at as dust by the Jews. And so Paul is talking to them, and Paul is telling them something glorious that happened to him. And here's what it is. Paul says, unto me, who am less than the least. Look at that phrase. Less than least. What am I? Less than least. You're least? I'm less. I least. Unto me, who am less than the least of all saints, is this grace given, that I should preach among the Gentiles the unsearchable riches of Christ. I love this passage. This passage is for us too. Now, you might say, well, don't compare yourself to the Apostle Paul. I'm not. I'm dust. I'm less than the least also. Like I said, comparing dust is irrelevant, right? Amen. Paul was also dust. But Paul said, this is what God did for me. He gave me this special grace. And what is that grace? That I should preach among the Gentiles the unsearchable riches of Christ. And when I think about the dust that I am, I realize that this verse is true of me as well. And I hope that it's true for you. I hope that it's true of everyone in this building. That we can say, God has given me the grace that I should preach among, and then you fill in that blank with whatever. The unsearchable riches of Christ. Who are you going to preach it among? I'm going to preach it among the Muslims in China. That's the grace that God has given me. Can I do it on my own? No. It's because He's given me the grace. Brother Ron Moreland is going to do it in Armenia. He's going to preach the unsearchable riches of Christ there. Where are you going to do it? Where are you going to do it? This is what God has given us as dust. He has given us the grace, the special grace to preach among the Gentiles or among the people of Grove City or among the people of Ohio or among the people of Russia or among the people of anywhere the unsearchable riches of Christ. 2 Corinthians 5, verses 18 through 21, Paul talks about how the what our mission is. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, he spells it out in really simple terms here. He says, verse 18, "And all things are of God, who hath reconciled us to himself by Jesus Christ, and hath given unto us the ministry of reconciliation, to wit, that God was in Christ, reconciling the world unto himself, not imputing their trespasses unto them, and hath committed unto us the word of reconciliation. Now then, we are ambassadors for Christ, as though God did beseech you by us, we pray you, in Christ's stead, be ye reconciled to God." Now, this language here sometimes is hard to wrap our minds around. It's older English. But let's think about this because it's not that complicated. He says, Christ was in the world reconciling the world to God. And that's what he has given us to do. In his stead, to ask the Gentiles and to everyone, be ye reconciled to God through the blood of Jesus Christ. Now, I hope that you can get this picture right here. We, this verse says, in Christ's stead. We're dust. What are we and who are we? Clay, humble, small, dust. But he has given us this to be in Christ's stead. And to say, be ye reconciled to God. If I can tell you what God does with dust, some of the things that I would tell you is things that have been happening in China in our lives over the past year. Because when I look at the things that have happened, I realize that none of it has happened because of me. And it makes me feel bad because you're paying me to go there and make stuff happen. I'm just putting it in simple terms. None of it's happening because of me. And I'm like, okay, I'm laying down on the job here. But it's God that does it because we're just dust. Some things that have happened is, I mean, even the tiniest little things. The last time I was in India in November, incidentally, where your pastor is, there were a bunch of students there, orphanage kids actually, that several years ago, the first time I had gone there, I had met these kids. Some of them weren't saved at the time. Some of them had just come to the orphanage off of places on the street. And so in November, this last November when I was there, I was doing a service with them, and these kids were singing. And I was sitting there, and I was like, what song is that? And I listened to it, and then I realized it was a song I had taught them several years ago. And they had, like, absorbed it into their minds, and then they had changed the music a little bit over the several years to kind of sound more Indian. And they changed the words a little bit just accidentally, just as time went by, because they didn't have it written down. They're just remembering it. And they're singing it year after year. And it was one of those moments that I realized what God can do with dust. I was sitting there and I was realizing, these kids worshiping God with all their heart with this song, I wouldn't have even recognized this song. It's changed so much. But I got the privilege of teaching them this song years ago that they're worshiping God with all their heart and with all their voice today. Is that about me? No. Was that something? No. It's about what God can do with dust. God can even bring dust, bring you around full circle to where he can say, hey, look at what I've been doing. In spite of the fact that you've been floundering around and blundering around and being dust, look at what I've been doing. I've been making something beautiful out of other dust. Amen. And then people coming up to me there and telling me, you know, several years ago, you preached such and such and such and such. And I had no idea. I didn't even remember. I'm like, I did? And they're like, yes. And it changed my life and did this and this. And now I'm in the Bible college or something like this, you know. And I'm like, wow, praise the Lord. I would have never thought of that or remembered it or thought that it was any good or done anything. But God is doing things with dust. God is at work. And in China, I can think of different, you know, the feeble and little things that we are and that we do. I'm going to talk about, you know, tell you one incident here that's going to, you know, it doesn't sound like missionary stuff at all. I'm in China, and we're there to reach a certain people group that speak the Sotokoli language. We didn't know of one single Christian among them. They had never had the Word of God. Their language isn't even written. And so I'm like, okay, how am I even going to go about meeting them, getting to know them, speaking to them, finding, you know, in this city where we live, finding the people that's of that language and being able to go, you know, through them and meet their families in the villages and stuff? How am I even going to go about that? Well, I'm just going about my life trying to be faithful, trying to do language learning, and I have a hobby. I like to do video projects. Well, somehow out there in the city, a man named Gawar heard that I like to do video projects. And so he's like, I've got to meet him. So we met, and we started talking. We became best friends. And Gawar is, he's like the man that we've been praying for. The man. Not only is he an expert in the Sotokoli language, because that's where he grew up, out there in a village in the middle of nowhere, he's introduced me to lots of other people, and today it looks like he's probably going to end up being our first Bible translation helper that's going to start working with us. How did that happen? Because of anything that we did? No. Because God is at work with dust. Just through a simple, you know, dumb thing, like a hobby that I'm messing around with, God used that to say, I'm going to use everything that you are. I'm going to use this dust, and I'm going to use it in magnificent ways that you don't even understand. Things that you can't do. Things that you can't control. Things like Levi's condition, our son. We were told that he has muscular dystrophy. He'll never be able to walk after a couple years. You know, he'll lose his ability to walk, and he'll never be able to walk again. His lifespan will be very short. Through that, God has given us amazing opportunities among our friends in China, to talk to them about who God is. I remember sitting on the couch with Gawar, my best friend there, and sitting there, and Gawar's not saved, and we're sitting there, and Gawar loves my son Levi with all his heart. You should just see him. It'll tear you up. He just loves Levi. And I told him, we're going to have to go back to the States to get Levi seen about, because he has a crippling condition, and he'll never be able to walk, and he won't live that long, you know. And Gawar was just devastated. And we talked about it and talked about it. And he's like, well, can't American doctors help and all this kind of stuff? And I'm like, and then he's like, well, I guess there's only one person who can help. I'm like, who's that? He's like, God. He's like, God can help, can't he? And I'm like, right you are. And guess what? God has. If I could tell you, and I don't have time now to tell you all about my son, how God has healed my son. And that is giving us more opportunities. Simple things like God using dust. Feeble. Frail dust. I remember sitting on a couch with Gawar and telling him for the first time what a Bible is. He had never heard of something like a Bible. So I'm telling him, this is the book that comes straight from God. God spoke and God gave us this so that we can know what's in his mind and what's in his heart and what he wants us to know about him. Now Gawar, when he was 3 years old, had asked his parents, who is God and where does he live? And they beat him for asking that. And so he had never asked again. And then getting opportunities with a man like this to sit in our house and explain who God is and where he lives. You asked this question when you were 3. And I didn't know that he had asked that until later. And then I'm just like, Lord, you are at work with dust. This is a group of people here. The Sotokoli people, this is a group of people that have never had the knowledge of God. There still isn't one word of Scripture translated into their language. They haven't read the Scriptures. They don't know. We know now of one Christian for sure among the entire people group. So this is a people group where there's nothing, no knowledge of God. You can't go in and plant a church and just preach to them and say, Jesus saves, because they're going to be like, what in the world did you just say? And now, after a short time, we see the beginnings of many things happening. It's very possible that a church could form soon. There's young people, young Tajik people, that God is at work in their hearts. This is God working with dust. I am thrilled to be able to stand here and tell you about these things. But I have to tell you that it's not us. We are a tiny, tiny, tiny part of the puzzle. It's God being at work in his world with dust. Now let's bring all this in for just a second. Some of us may be thinking, some of you guys may be thinking, well, that all sounds great. It sounds great that God can breathe into dust the breath of life. It sounds great that he can touch us, messed up and flawed human beings as we are, and use us for his purpose. Use us to open the eyes of the blind and to reach people in our city and around the world. That sounds great. But I don't feel that I have that connection with the Maker, with Jesus, with the one who breathes life into dust. You can have. You need the breath of life. You need to be born again. We're all just dust. I'm not better than you. You can't think, well, that's not for me because you don't understand how messed up I am. Come on. Do I need to make the point any more clearly? Dust? God specializes in dust. If you have never experienced the breath of life in your soul, let God's fingers touch that dust that you are and lift you up and breathe the breath of life into you. How does it happen? Job chapter 42 and verse 6 is one last verse. Well, I might have one or two verses here that I'm going to read in closing. Job chapter 42 and verse 6. Job chapter 42 and verse 6. This is Job after he has seen God for who he is. After he has gone through all the trials and he's seen God and he tells God, verse 6, wherefore I abhor myself and repent in dust and ashes. That's what it takes right there. You can't come to God believing that you are something, that you are somebody. You've got to come to God believing that you are nothing. Because that's when God will make you something. God wants you with all his heart. But he's not going to take you unless you humble yourself and say, God, I'm tired of who I am. I abhor who I am. I can't deal with it any longer. I'm not enough. There's no righteousness that we have that can get us to heaven. There's nothing that we have. And like Job said, I repent in dust and ashes. Is there any heart here this morning who says, that's what I need? I need to just, on my face before God, repent as dust and say, God, would you take me with your hand and breathe the breath of everlasting life? Give me that everlasting life that you promised. You can have it through the blood of Jesus Christ. Amen. Jesus Christ, God's Son, not only loves us as dust, but gave his life, came and became a body of dust, just like me and you, with the pains and aches that we have, and was nailed to a cross, and died for your sins, for my sins, for all the dust, for all the sins of the world. Would you do that this morning if you haven't? There's no sense in just being like, yeah, well, I'll just kind of let that soak in and see how it feels. Walk out of here, and you forget. Dust is complete. We're completely wrapped up in all the other goings on, all the dust storm of this world. Whoo, you know. Now is the time. And Christians, people who have been born again, children of God, you might be thinking, well, what if I can't measure up to all the stuff that we're talking about? I love missions, okay? This is a Sunday. I love missions. It's supposed to be a Sunday of rejoicing, not of deep conviction. But let's think about this for a second. What if you're saying, would God let me be a part with who I am? Do you understand who I am, how few capabilities I have, or how little I have to offer? Guys, look at me. Look at how little. Look how little that we have to offer. Genesis chapter 18 and verse 47. Genesis chapter 18 and verse 47. This is the last verse. And this is one of the most beautiful verses. Genesis 18 and verse 47. This is for you Christians. People who don't think that God will let you be a part of some effort to reach the world, of missions in some way or another. Genesis 18 and verse 47. Now this is Abraham talking to God. And Abraham was pleading for the life of other people here. I say verse 47. I think it's 27. There's not 47 verses, okay? Verse 27. This is Abraham pleading for the lives of sinners. Is there anything other than this in missions? This is Abraham pleading with God. And Abraham comes to God and God says, I'm going to go down and I'm going to wipe out this wicked city. And Abraham says, wait, what if you find a few righteous people there? Couldn't you spare it? Couldn't you give everybody in the city another chance? And Abraham says in verse 27, Abraham answered and said, behold now, I have taken upon me to speak unto the Lord, which am what? Dust and ashes. Abraham says, Lord, I'm pleading with you face to face to spare these people. And he's like, I've taken this upon me. And he's like, if I can talk to you about this. And Abraham is approaching all tentatively here. What did God do? Did God smack Abraham down and says, what are you talking about? Get out of my way. I'm busy about my work here, and I can't be bothered by dust. Did God say that? Will God say that to you, Christians? Christians, you can just ask the Lord. Pray every day. Lord, I see all kinds of people in the Bible that you used for something spectacular. Some of them were awesome people. Some of them were not. Some of them were just like me. So choose to use me, please. And he will, because he is looking for vessels of clay and for dust that's yielded to him and that just wants to be a part of what he's doing. This is what Abraham said. He's like, I've taken upon me to speak to you, and I'm just dust and ashes. God spared Lot because of that. God was at work. God will take that dust. Let's, in closing here, let's just think about this invitation. For those of you who are born again, what else is there besides this in missions? Why do I love missions? This is why I love missions right here. Because I know who I am. I'm not Superman. I can't liberate a country. I'm just dust. But God picked me up. God can use dust, and only God can. Christians, do you want to offer the dust that we are to the Lord this morning? And say, Lord, I love what you are doing. I want to be a part of it. Take this clay, take this dust, take this vessel. Just make me a part of what you're doing. God is doing something among the Tajik people in China. It's not because of me or for me, but I want to be a part of it. I just want to be a part of it. What do you want to be a part of this morning? In 1 John, it talks about we can be a part of the world if we choose to. There's only death down that line. Unsaved folks, in a crowd this size, there might be folks here who are unsaved. Why after today? Think about that. We're going to return to the dust. That's a scary thought if you don't have a maker that's got you in his hand and redeemed you from the dust and lifted you up out of that pit and promised you an eternity in heaven and bought you with his blood. I wouldn't be able to bear the thought of returning to the dust without that. Amen? Let's think about that. Let's bow our heads and pray. Dear Lord, I trust that you've moved in some heart this morning. Lord, I thank you for what missions is and that you use me as a part, a small part though I am. Lord, I thank you that you use dust. What else do we have to offer? We have nothing else to offer. But you take us. You lift us up. Lord, please use us to touch the eyes of the blind. Lord, please use us to shine the light of the gospel in the darkness. Please let us be a part of your mission, Lord. And let us love you and love what you're doing because of this. Thank you for using dust. Lord, if there's anybody here who's not saved and not born again, I pray that today would be the day that they accept you as their Savior. Lord, that they would ask for the breath of life, Lord. That they would accept the gift of salvation that you offer. That they would repent, Lord, realizing that we are nothing before you. That we have no righteousness. Lord, just be at work here in hearts this morning, Lord. Thank you so much for the opportunity you've given us to be together in your house. In your name we pray. Amen.
Let's all stand as you have your head bowed and eyes closed. The instrumentalist will play. The altar's open. When's the last time you thought of yourself as dust? Creator wants to use you. The potter wants to use you. God's specialty is dust. Let's sing that chorus together. I surrender all. I surrender all. All to thee, my blessed Savior. I surrender all. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for just a great message this morning. Lord, I pray that we would take this and just recognize who we are and how grateful we can be that you use dust. Lord, we're just amazed of how great you are. Lord, I pray that you would dismiss us with your care. Bring us back tonight as we look again to your word. In Jesus' precious and holy name we do pray. Amen. 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 Before we sing our song of dismissal, remember the postcards. If you would, pick those up and fill those out. If you can't get them done today, go ahead and take them anyway and bring them back Wednesday. That's okay. Well, we want to get them out as soon as we can, all right? And Brother and Mrs. Cleghorn, if you want to go back and stand at your table, that would be wonderful. They have a table set up there in the foyer, and make sure and see them on your way out. Let's sing Family of God. All right. I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. I've been washed in the fountain, cleansed by his blood, joined hands with Jesus as we travel this sod. For I'm a part of the family of God. Amen. You are dismissed. We'll see you tonight. There is no Christian growth class tonight, all right?